he discovered Stravinsky's The Rite of Spring. In that ballet from 1913, Weinzweig heard all the tonal color and rhythmic vitality he wasn't getting from Berg and Schoenberg. He began searching for a style that would embrace both worlds. Meanwhile, the pieces Weinzweig composed at Eastman reflected his early interest in the tone poems of composers like Berlioz and Liszt. He was tempted to capitalize on this flair for the dramatic.
At the time I went to Eastman, I did consider going to Hollywood. And of course, remember, this was still Depression era, and the prospects were not very good. And I realized that Hollywood was not waiting for me. And so I came back home in the fall of 1938.
I think the thing that stunned everybody really about Weinzweig when he came back from his graduate work in the States and started to make a career for himself in Toronto was that he regarded himself as a professional composer.
Composer John Beckwith.
And there are a lot of people writing music in Canada going back over 100 years, 150 years, but most of them didn't primarily think of themselves as composers and certainly wouldn't have thought of making a career concentrating on composition in that way.
The typical picture of a composer in Canada, up until John Weinzweig, was that this was something that you did on the side. So if we take a composer like Alexis Cotin in Montreal, he wrote a wide range of materials, including working on a full-scale grand opera. But at the same time, he was an organist for most of his life, and he had a large class of students. And that was really the way he made his living. His compositional activity was something he did on the side.
And Weinzweig came in just cutting through all that by saying, I'm going to be a composer. I'm a composer. Not I'm going to be, but I'm a composer. And I'm teaching composition. And very, very sweet students at first as a freelance teacher. But I'm a teacher of composition. I'm a composer of film music, of radio music. And that was novel.
Good evening. From Massey Hall in Toronto, the CBC brings you the Toronto Symphony Orchestra in the first Tuesday evening concert of the 1943 season. Our conductor this evening is, as usual, Sir Ernest McMillan. The program will open with the tone poem The Enchanted Hill by the Toronto composer John Weinzweig. Mr. Weinzweig is one of the most important of the younger Canadian composers, and his works have been performed in both England and the United States. The Enchanted Hill translates into music the moods of a fantastic poem by Walter de la Mare.
Well, The Enchanted Hill was my orchestral thesis at the Eastman School of Music for my master's degree. It was getting its premiere with the Toronto Symphony under Sir Ernest McMillan. And my wife was giving birth to our first son, Paul, on January the 6th, 1943. And my wife was at the hospital. She agreed that I should be at Massey Hall for the concert, and that she would be able to hear it on radio in the hospital. And so she heard the premiere of the work from Massey Hall at the time that she was giving birth to Paul. So that was a double birth. It was the birth of the Enchanted Hill and the birth of my first son.
Mm-hmm.
John Weinzweig's early orchestral works caught the attention of conductor and violinist Samuel Hirschenhorn. He was leader of the CBC orchestra that played the incidental music for radio dramas and documentaries. Hirschenhorn pioneered the use of original music in CBC's radio productions. He sensed the dramatic potential of Weinzweig's music despite its modern sound. Weinzweig rapidly turned into one of CBC Radio's most prolific in-house composers. Violinist Eugene Cash.
This was still at the old CBC studios on Davenport Road, you know. We had the actors in the same studio, the sound effects man, and the orchestra. So the ensemble was complete.
And so I was brought in to do the first series. That was called New Homes for Old. Now that sounds like a real estate program, but it wasn't. It was really about people who had survived a life in their country and had fled in order for a better life, you know, in the Western world. And they'd come to Canada and they had a story to tell. And so that's how it started in May of 1941.
The CBC presents the eighth program in the series, New Homes for Old. Tonight we tell the story of one who watched with ever-saddening heart the deliverance of Germany into the hands of those lusters after blood who now control her destiny and construe her ruin. One who saw through the eyes of a great German novelist the inevitable end of it all.
Inner landscape is inherent in the soul and born with it into the world. It determines the color and nature of our ideals. Our inner landscape is the crystal center of life itself, the spot where its laws are dictated and the source of its actual destiny.
Weinzweig is engaged to do his first score. He's just back from Eastman School. And he's got a head full of Schoenbergiana, 12-tone system and everything. And I never forget, there's this scene where we in the string section play ta tu pu pa ta ta pa poop, and it's a complete 12-tone role. And at the rehearsal, some of the string section of the orchestra snickered a little at the unusual harmony, and Sammy stopped the orchestra, said, "None of that." They laughed at Beethoven, too.
Between 1941 and 45, Weinzweig composed the scores for over 100 CBC radio dramas and documentaries. His radio experience led to work for the National Film Board, where he wrote music for documentaries on nationalist themes. These were the war years, and Weinzweig did service as a band instructor for the Royal Canadian Air Force. He'd started teaching composition at the Toronto Conservatory in 1939. At war's end, he returned to teaching. He was determined to take Canadian students away from the small world of the English tradition. Along with theory and orchestration, Weinzweig's students learned the Chinese scale. They studied Balinese music and Indian ragas, along with jazz and the blues. Weinzweig taught at the conservatory from 1945 to 1969. In 1952, he was appointed to the faculty of the University of Toronto. His new approach to teaching would revolutionize the art of composition in Canada.